Hello, this is Peter Combs from Bidamount.com and P.L. Combs Asian Antiques here in Gloucester, Massachusetts. And we've put a video together today to discuss only Famille Rose porcelains of the 19th century to the end of the Qing Dynasty. This was a very prolific period, and if you're new to collecting Chinese porcelain, you're likely to encounter a lot of it out there, especially here in the United States and in Europe. Famille Rose was developed originally in the late Kangxi period, the very end of that period, and it became a turning point for Chinese porcelain decorators throughout the 18th and into the 19th century. And we're going to start with this first piece. This is a style of plate that was developed during the Qinlong period, the peach pattern plate. And these were given usually on, I believe it was 60th birthdays. They continued to be made right through the 18th, 19th, and into the 20th century. This is a late 19th century example. And it has the back here, this very typical back, that sort of stout cream-colored foot in bamboo leaf decoration. We'll see a few more of these as we go along. Here is a set of nesting cups. And these were produced during the, around the mid to the late 19th century. They're fairly thin-walled, very delicately painted, and usually depict scenes of daily domestic life in China and people pursuing activities. I love the horse in this. The Chinese do great things when they paint horses, so always keep an eye out. They're very expressive, often cartoonish in appearance. Here's the bottom of these cups and what they look like. The glaze ends pretty neatly around the foot. There's a little trimming there. They have to be trimmed because after these cups are all produced, they're intended to be used and placed in stacks like this. The feet aren't nice and neatly done. They'll chip away the enamel from the into the paste below it on the next cup down. But they're very collectible and they're quite valuable these days. So if you see a set, try to buy them. And this is it's a European form. This was a fairly large piece. This was about 8 inches wide. It's a hair receiver, but the decoration is pure mid-19th century. And here's a view of the bottom with those little spur marks. There's 5 of them on there. These are also known as saggers. They're placed on there to support the bottom of the piece while it's being fired. You see them on Chinese, but more often on Japanese things, but that's a Chinese example. Here is a lozenge-shaped plate, mid-19th century or later. They were produced in very large quantities for use in China, and a lot of them were exported. And this is the bottom of it. Notice it has some orange peel in the white glaze, the faux rubber stamp applied Qinlong mark on the bottom, and that very classic paste on the foot. Always look at the foot. This is a 19th century rendition of a mid-18th century style plate. Notice it's borderless, but very delicately painted, very artistically drawn. Always look at these and see how well the artist outlined in black, very fine black, the leaves, and then how carefully they filled them in with blues and greens. And also look at the flowers. They delicately painted these flowers. These were all done freehand, of course. And they varied the pressure of the brush, so you get light and dark petals. It gives it the appearance of different types of light hitting the flower. Very nice. And here's the back of it. Similar to the other one, it has a mark on it, typical foot. And they use bats, an auspicious symbol for longevity and good luck in China. And bats are often used. Next, we have this very attractive large. This was about a 25-inch tall early part of the 19th century vase. It's got fantastically done large Fu lions on the neck in pink and blue, and it's a scene depicting the arrival of a dignitary, and he's being greeted. And above the scene is two very well done chimeras, or baby dragons. It's a classic type of vase, and here's a view of what the foot rim will look like on that. If you flipped it over, this is what you want to see. You see little knife marks where they trimmed the paste. And it's a very typical example, and very well done. All right. Now we have this rather nice, nicely done plate, made in the mid to late 19th century. Very nicely spaced, good use of color, and with bats and cash symbols for good luck around the inside. And here's the back again with bamboo decoration and that classic foot. This foot was kind of dirty. I didn't clean it. when we took the pictures, but it's the right thing. Here we have a pair of rose medallion with Mandarin scene vases. Notice again the Fu lines on the neck, the chimeras on the shoulder, and they're done in gilt. And then you have this. This is a late 19th century example. Similar to the rose medallion, but they don't have the green areas. It's all just open landscapes. And there's the bottom of it. Got a little burned in the kiln. It's not unusual to see this, especially in late 19th century examples. And they don't affect the value as long as the enamels aren't burned. All right. They call these birthday plates or celebration plates because they have a lot of auspicious symbols and so forth in the interiors. They're very nicely painted. They were done in the latter part of the 19th century, pretty typically, and have very soft colors. And they're not meticulously drawn. They're sort of almost focally drawn. So it's what you want to expect to see on those. And there's the back again. Again, you see the bamboo decoration, typical use of the 19th century with that same foot as we saw before. So when you see that, you're in safe ground. This is a very lovely little tile. It was done in the late 19th century, but the decoration on it is quite lovely, and it's simple. It's nice and simple. An elder, a scholar, a teacher with a student, somebody is whispering a message to him. And notice the squiggly lines and the outlining in the black. This was a painting technique that became popular in the late 19th and into the early 20th century. When you look at the back of these, this is what they look like. You see these vertical lines, how they laid the paste out on a table, and that's how they were joined. Those lines do not indicate, somebody asked me this recently, does that mean it's 18th century? It has those lines. It does not. They had them well into the 20th century. Now you have this. This is a late 19th century Famille Rose vase, very simply done, very typical form, with that high foot and spreading mouth. And we have this. It's a mid-late 19th century covered jar with a little peach handle, sort of quickly drawn. They made these in fairly large numbers. And they often had this on the bottom, chin lung marks. That mark you'll see, especially in four characters, used over and over and over right through the 20th, right into the 20th century, and they still use it to this very day. So it doesn't mean anything about the age. Now, this is an interesting little mid-late 19th century paste box. It has a mixture of techniques. It has underglazed blue, overglazed Famille Rose, and underglazed Daosai enamels. There was on the lid, you see there's the dragon and the phoenix pattern with a flaming pearl in the middle. And this was the result of some experimentation that went on with these porcelains by the potters back then. They mixed it up a bit. Here's a detail shot of the foot. Notice the piece has a faux six-character chin lung mark on this. Notice how thick the glaze sort of pooled up there where the foot begins to turn out. It'll be suffused with a lot of bubbles. And this is a detail of a very large rose mandarin vase we had, jar with a lid. It was about 24 inches tall. And that very nice Greek key border, which became popular in the early 19th century, even on imperial pieces. And this one is very nicely done, very good detail all over, no holding back on the colors at all. And this, again, is an early 19th century example. They call them cider jugs. And they were made for export. Notice the big strap handles on the sides, the Fu lion on the top. And very typical and quite collectible these days. The foot was neatly trimmed on these. The base underneath, you'll notice the paste is a little messy, which is not unusual on export pieces. They often didn't pay much attention to them. And this is another one of these early to mid 19th century rose mandarin, rose medallion jars with the Fu lion, big lid on it. This was probably about a 15 inch jar. And here's a pattern repeated again. This is how it would look on a cut corner bowl made for the export market. A lot of these were sent to the United States in the 19th century as well as Europe. You're not unlikely you'll find them. And they did export and make garden barrels in rose medallion and rose mandarin. And mostly during the mid-19th century, right up to the end, and they were sent in large quantities. Notice the cutouts, for the cash symbols on the side, the interlocking cash symbols for good luck, and those sort of big rounded lugs they mounted garden barrels with. Typically, even back into the Ming Dynasty, they used those. And there's a detail of the ladies. There's traces of gilt still in their hair. Gilding often got worn off on rose medallion and rose mandarin and export pieces. It was very susceptible to wear, especially if you used ammonia or Windex or something to clean it. Strips the gilding right off. Here's the bottom of one of these, big hole in the middle, and a slightly concave cavetto, unglazed, neatly trimmed. People still use them to sit on them. This is a bottle vase. Again, has that same scene, that sort of repetitive cartouche that they like to use, again with the Greek key border and white neck with flowers all over it. The base on this was very nicely glazed, though unusual for these. It's got some orange peel, but the foot neatly trimmed, nice color, a little bit of grit on the lower right. Very typical. In addition to doing them on white ground, they also made these on celadon grounds. Here's a pair of them. They have garlic mouths on them, garlic-shaped mouths, but virtually identical pattern, just done in celadon. There's a close-up of it. Notice also more of the gilding in the hair, the beautifully done, luxurious use of color. They applied it rather thickly, and they were highly collected all over the United States and Europe. Now here we have an export plate, mid-19th century, with a vase filled with flowers and butterflies and a scholar's books on the right and precious objects. Very typical, often exported to the Persian markets as well as Europe. And here's the bottom of it. Notice the kiln grit. Quite typical. And a neatly neatly finished inverted foot. These are a very typical bottom of one of these plates. This was a reticulated tazza. Probably for a birthday or something. There was some sort of maybe a wedding, a celebration with the fish on there. And there's a little court scene. And it's got sort of a high foot under it. We're going to flip it over. And there's the foot. Stands up on that. It's unglazed but on the foot edge. But it's glazed all the way up into the middle. And you can see actually where they joined the base to the plate when they were making it. There's a slight line there. That's not a crack. This is a tea caddy. It's a European form that was... These were made to order starting in the middle latter part of the 18th century, and this was made in the mid-19th. And again, with the Mandarin scene, here's the bottom of it. They're all tea caddies from that 100-year period. Look basically like this, with a flat unglazed bottom. You'll see little iron imperfections in the paste from when it was fired. It's pretty typical. It's a nice little example. And here are a group of plates that were made during the bowls, rather, that were made during the first half of the 19th century, coral red and Famille Rose, some with inscriptions. They turn up also fairly often in the West. And here we have a pair of first half of the 19th century export plates with a monogram B on them. These were custom made for somebody. They were made to order. Nicely done blue enamels around the exterior, good looking interior, butterflies and so forth. And here's the back. Again, you have that nice white, this one has a nice white glossy back on it, and a very clean foot, very white foot. It's a little unusual for these. Often they're more buff colored. There's another view of it. There are traces of kiln grit on this foot, like there were in the other examples. You can see them in the upper right there. Pretty typical. And what you expect to see on these. All right, we're going to move over. Now we're going to look at this. This is a late 19th century Yen Yen vase. On a pink ground with rather colorful enamels applied over it. The contrasting colors are very appealing. This is a late vase. This could have even been made in the early 20th century at the end of the Qing Dynasty. It has the double blue ring on the bottom. This does not mean it was meant for the imperial court, as often people say. They just applied it out of tradition, really. At this point, they just put double rings on lots of things. Here are a pair of reticulated table lanterns done with open work is done through the cash symbols and these panels depicting figures and landscape scenes with clouds. Here's the bottom of it. When you take them apart, those are what the feet look like. You can see the hole where the candle would stick up through, where the lamp would be put. And they're very attractive lit. If you have one, try lighting it sometime. They make a wonderful atmosphere. We have a large pair of Guangshu boxes. These were made in the very late end of the 19th century, but beautifully painted. These were big. These are about 12 inches wide. Very heavy, but nicely done. again, those outlines of the of everything, and then filled in with green, neatly done. Notice how well done the flowers and the fruit are done on these. They're excellent. And there's the bottom, the mark, and that little crusty foot. This is not an imperial box. It just has an imperial rain mark on them. They just use the mark. And here we have a late 19th century. This is a mix. It's a crackle glaze vase. It's got a cafe au lait, notice, upper section with Famille Rose. It's got that relief work done in like a dry paste biscuit. It was to simulate bronze mounts. And here's the scene, a close-up of a Lohan or a scholar figure sitting outside with a flower basket and an attendant. Very nice quality, though, and I love the crackle on these. Completely intentional. Now we have a pair of late 19th century hat stands. The holes are there to vent. You put your hat on top of it so your hat will dry out during the night. It's quite muggy in China. And these birds are fairly typical. These black birds really came into vogue in the late 19th century. You see them on a lot of porcelains. But this is a nicely done pair. Unfortunately, one of them had some damage to it, but it's a good example. When you flip these over, these are the bottoms, and they have neatly done stamped rain marks. One of them on the right is a little off-center, but that's okay. And again, we have a peach pattern teapot. This is a late 19th century example. It has wire handles on it, but nicely done, very carefully done, and well done branches with its original lid. And there's the bottom of this. Very nice foot, and doesn't push over at all. It doesn't interfere with the appearance of the piece, and the pot sits nice and flat. Then you have this. These are the second half of the 19th century. They made a lot of these footed tots and bowls. This is a sort of an oblong shaped one with neatly done flowers, and they exported them in large numbers. Sometimes they're marked. This one is not marked. Marks often don't mean much on these. They just sort of, some of them actually made up marks as they went along. But that's what the bottom of one looks like. All right. And then you have this little barrel form food box. It's got a metal loop handle on the top, and it has a slight ribbing in the body, which was sort of a carry forward from Kangxi porcelains, were often ribbed, especially vases. And here's a close-up. You can see the ribbing there. Here's a close-up of the figures, some women, a young girl, and a very small girl out there doing some activity in the woods, which is there often depicted. There's the foot on it. Not badly done. It's a little dark. It's kind of dirty. It would probably clean up to a fairly nice white with a little effort. But that's what the bottom of these second half pieces will look like. Here's a Tongxi period wine pot with a big butterfly in the middle. This butterfly pattern with that long wing, you'll see these on bowls and plates and teapots and vases. And there's the mark on the bottom. And by the latter part of the 19th century, it's not uncommon to see those rings on the turnings of the foot. You see them on early pieces trying to be early, Qinlong and so forth. They're probably fakes. Now we have this handsome pair of vases with sort of a honeycomb pattern with open cartouches of interior scenes of scholars and their attendants and women looking on. A lovely scene, very classical Chinese scenes. And if you turn them over, this vase over, this is what the foot will look like. Somebody had drilled these. These had been lamps at one point. But notice the paste, nice quality. And here you have a pair of Famille June or Famille Rose dragon plates. Wildly, sort of a wild scene of the phoenix in the center with the dragon. And seeking out the pearl, no doubt. And if you turn it over, this is what you're going to see. Again, this kiln grit adhering around the interior and a chin lung mark. Here we have a large pair of Famille Rose square slab construction vases with iron red Fu lions on the side, the masks. These are mirrored pairs. Here's a detail, again, with that black bird that grew and grew and grew and became more popular as the 19th century progressed. But nicely done, good quality colors, and well painted all the way around. And here's a picture of the bottom of these. Notice the foot. The feet are very neatly cut, very neatly trimmed, nice clear paste. Slightly different color, even though they are a pair, because they were made to separate vases, and then they matched them with the enamels. And here you have a 19th century pair of ovoid shaped Famille Rose with a little Famille Noir. Basket flowers of baskets, basket the pattern all around it. Here's a nice view of the neck. Very well painted. This is a very pretty pair of jars. They were probably made in the middle late 19th century. Here's a view of the foot. You notice how the enamels were added after the foot was trimmed, and they sort of spill up onto the unglazed portion of the foot with the downstroke of the brush. Here's a pricket stick, mid-19th century. These generally, when you see them, are quite good quality. They spent time on these bats and cash symbols at the base, and if you flip them up on its side, you see this. You have sort of an interior view. It's a landscape with a person beckoning a child to climb down out of the tree, and on the right, two children, one with a rue scepter and one with a paintbrush. Charming. Here's the underside of it. It's a concave bottom with a hole, obvious hole in the middle, which is where the stick itself was inserted. It's unglazed, nice quality paste. It's well done. Again, notice the bamboo leaves around the outside. And this is a big seated Buddha. These generally are around 12 inches tall. I always call these brick patterns because of the brickwork on the in the textile. These are very collectible in China these days. Here's a view of the bottom. There is a seal mark to the upper left of the hole in the middle. You'll see it. There's an oval seal mark. It's usually from a particular workshop that made them. They made a lot of these, and they're heavily collected. They could sell for thousands of dollars today. Here's a Dao Quan period compartmented food box with a peach handle. And there's just shaped sides. The interior is all compartmentalized, as you're going to see in a second. We're going to look at the top. There it is, the insects. Very classic pattern for this period, with the peaches and the insects feeding on the flowers, the abundance of spring. Everything's going wild. There's a little more close-up. Again, you can see the outline in black of the leaves and how carefully they wash in the greens and the yellowish-green colors. Very typical. There's the interior. Isn't that lovely? All beautifully done, each with its own scene. And in the center, a scene of a grasshopper feeding on a flower. And on the lower left is a frog. And it's very typical. Here's a picture of the bottom. There it is. There's the mark, the Dao Quan mark. Nice and neatly done. A good-looking foot. This is a better quality example. And then back to the Buddhas for a minute. We're going to look at a couple more of these. This is a Famille Jun example with yellow. Nice toning of the face, skin coloring. Some of those flowers in his hand were broken. It was unfortunate. We didn't break it. They came that way. But there's the bottom of it again. They always have the hole in the bottom of these big Buddhas because they were generally hollow and they would explode if they didn't put a vent hole in them while they were being fired. And here's another Buddha. This was a smaller one. It was about 9 inches tall, and I think it's a bit older, judging by the toning and the color around the face, the rosing and the softness of the tones. But it's a nice example. And there's the bottom of it with a very pronounced square seal to the lower right there. And a nice neatly done hole. And the base is nice and thick. Notice how thick the paste is. Later examples are much thinner. Now here's a detail shot of the seal mark, the potter's mark on the bottom of this figure. It's very neatly done. And if you have a directory, you can certainly look them up. I suspect he won't be too hard to find if you're interested in finding out who the maker was on these. And here's a picture of a scholar, a nice seated scholar, again with that brick pattern in his robe of the second half of the 19th century, pretty typical. Nicely done though, this is a good quality example. Notice the gray and the rocky plinth. Here's a picture of the bottom. The base on this was quite thick. When you look at the hole, you realize how thick the paste was when they applied it. And there were some little bits of impurity in the clay when they made it, so it turned rust color. This is the last example, the Guan Yin. A very pretty one. The sloping shoulders, the beautiful enamels, and the positioning of the hands is quite lovely. And the vent hole on this was on the back, so when you turn this one over, all you see is this sort of little rough bottom. It's a little bit crude. They didn't do a great job cleaning it up, but the rest of the piece is quite attractive. So that's what you really want to aim for anyway when you're looking to buy things. And that's the end of this video. We have some others on the site that are on YouTube as well for Yi Xing and Blue and White that we've done very similarly to this. Check them out. You might find them useful. and come back anytime and look at it again, you know, or stop it in the middle of a comment and study the pictures and see how they look to you. And if you have any questions about anything, feel free to get a hold of us through our website at Bidamount. And I want to thank you very much for taking the time to listen, and I hope you find it useful. Thank you very much.